Good evening, everyone. We're going to try that one more time. Good evening, everyone. My name is Dr. Marjorie Dieg. I'm an assistant principal over at Penndale Middle School, and I'm also a member of North Penn School District's Proficiency and Equity Executive Committee. It is so amazing to see everyone here tonight, and we are beyond excited to have this amazing event come together and see our student perform their talents and their skills. Before we get started, I would like to extend a special thank you to the League of Employees of African Descent at Merck for all of their help, support, and contributions to tonight's event. We would also like to thank Mr. David DeValentino and the Jazz Band for their amazing performance in the lobby. Wouldn't you agree? Now I would like to take a moment to introduce our judges. I will be reading an excerpt from their biographies, which you can find in our program. Tamara Della Anderson is a multi-talented producer, activist, singer, actor, writer, and director. She is a founding member of the Racial Justice Organizing Committee, Black Lives Matter at School, the Melanated Educators Collective, and is the curator of the BIPOC Database and Resource Guides. Ms. Tamara Della Anderson. Mr. Nicholas Bernardini. He is a 14-year public school educator, labor organizer, social activist, musician, artist, husband, and father of three ladies. He is the co-founder of Philly Hub for Laboratory Academics and a core member of the Racial Justice Organized Committee. Mr. Nicholas Bernardini. Dr. Jill Clark. Dr. Clark is currently the CEO of a Philadelphia charter school and has served as principal and teacher in the Montgomery County Schools. She's also an adjunct professor at LaSalle and Gwinnett Mercy Universities. Dr. Clark, a married mother of two, joins us this evening in honor of her late mother, Julia Parker, who was a beloved teacher for 30 years at our very own Gwen Noor Elementary. Dr. Jill Clark. Ms. Jamel Johnson. Mrs. Johnson is an educator, author, mentor, singer, and songwriter. She has been a part of the North Penn School District for 18 years. She's the other half of Tommy J, the husband and wife singing duo. Mrs. Johnson is also the author of the published book, Quotes and Jokes, A Mental Detox for Tweens and Teens. Mrs. Jamel Johnson. And last but not least, Mr. George Whitehair. Mr. George Whitehair has been the chair of the publicity for the International Spring Festival, one of Pennsylvania's largest multicultural organizations, and is now the lead researcher, historian, author, and one of the driving forces behind the legacy of Dr. Frank E. Boston, who opened a hospital right here in Lansdale. He recently published We Are You, a book on the contributions of immigrants. Mr. George Whitehair. We thank you all. And now, without further ado, I would like you to give, please, a large round of applause to our master of ceremonies for this evening, Mr. Isaiah Jha.
Good evening, good evening. Can I get one more round of applause for everybody participating? So first I will be talking about the significance of the Pan-African flag. From the 16th to the 19th century, millions of enslaved people were transported from West and Central Africa to the Americas as a part of a nefarious financial enterprise known as the transatlantic slave trade. The Middle Passage was a stage of the journey where thousands of African people from various tribes were inhumanely packed into ships and sailed to the West Indies to be auctioned off as chattel to suitors from the various European colonies in the North, Central, and South America. Once enslaved Africans arrived at their destined colony, they underwent a seasoning process where their language and original cultural identity was virtually eradicated, and they were forced to assume the cultural identity of their oppressor. This mass displacement in culture incarceration of millions of West and Central Africans is known as African diaspora. In the 20th century, the first wave of civil rights movement took place where several prominent African-American leaders and organizations began to agitate for political, economic, and social changes for the peoples of African diaspora. One of the most well-known organizations at the time was called the Universal Negro Improvement Association, which was led by Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey and the UNIA promoted black reparation, unity, self-sufficiency, and cooperative economics. It was during this time that the UNIA created the Pan-African flag as a symbol of black solidarity in Americans, since the peoples of the people of African diaspora are all derived from a myriad of African cultures. The Pan-African flag's colors wave symbolizes the following: red for the blood of the enslaved African ancestors, black for the skin color, and green to represent the color of ancestral lands from which their ancestors originated. Currently, the Pan-African flag continues to stand as the symbol of unity and hope for the people of the African diaspora to continue to strive for an equal footing in the Americas. While some people in the African diaspora subscribe to a specific ethnicity or nationality in the Americas, the Pan-African flag encompasses the people that identify as Afro-Latinx, Afro-Caribbean, and African-American. And now, for the Black National Anthem, Myra Jefferson will be singing. Please rise. One more round of applause for my era. She can sing. I'm telling y'all. And now, this will be our oratorical presentations for group one, grades 4 through 5. We have Isabella Lazinski from Bridal Path, and she's in grade 4.
I'm Isabella Lazinski, and I'll be performing Phenomenal Woman by Maya Angelou. Pretty woman, wonder where my secrets lie. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model's size. But when I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say, It's in the reach of my arms, the span of my hip, the strut of my step, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman, phenomenally. Phenomenal woman, that's me. I walk into a room just as cool as you please, and to a man, the fellows stand or fall down to their knees. Then they swarm around me, a hive of honeybees. I say, it's in the fire in my eyes, in the flash of my teeth, the swing in the waist, and the joy in my feet. I'm a woman. Phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. Men themselves have wondered what they see in me. They try so much, but they can't touch my inner mystery. When I try to show them, they say they still can't see. I say, it's in the arch of my back, the sun of my smile, the ride of my breasts, the grace of my style. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. Now you understand just why my head's not bowed. I don't shout or jump about or have to talk real loud. When you see me passing, it ought to make you proud. I say, it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair, the palm of my hand, the need for my care, 'cause I'm a woman. Phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me.
One more time for Isabella. And now we will have Sanvi Wagmer from Nash, and she's in grade 4.
And I'm a fourth grade student at General Nash Elementary School. Today I'm going to be presenting a speech named You Survived It by Viola Davis. When I was 25, I went to Juilliard right next door. Not a very good experience, by the way. And I remember at one point I felt like I lost my voice as an artist. I said, who am I really? You know, what am I doing here? You know, how am I gonna be different from everyone else? So I decided to go on a cultural arts safari in Africa. I made Juilliard pay for it. And I went to the Gambia, and I went to the Mandinka tribe. And one day there were these group of women called Kenyala who went to the compound, Mandinka women. And they were dressed in oversized clothes, and they'd paint on their faces, and they carried drums, and they were shouting really, really loudly, and they made really funny faces. And they had calabashes filled with this dish that tasted like peanut-flavored oatmeal. And they just got louder and louder, and they passed the calabash around to everybody in the compound. And more people started yelling and screaming with them, to a point where they're falling over each other, hundreds of people, children even. And they passed the calabash, plopped the foods in their mouths, look up to the sky, scream, scream, scream. And they would sing this song that's translated into, I did not come here for food, my stomach is full. I did not come here for food, I came here for something much, much more than that. And I was wondering who these women were. And I found out that these women were actually infertile. And in the Gambia, the biggest blessing that you could possibly have is to be able to have a child. And these women felt like the only reason why they weren't blessed with the child was because God did not hear their wish. And so the whole point of the ritual was to make as much noise as possible so that God could hear them and pour down the blessing. The beauty of that ritual was that it was actually a ritual, an actual something that they could do to get what they wanted in their lives. The beauty of that ritual was the participation. The beauty of that ritual was the people who were surrounding these women who said, you know what, God didn't hear you, did not see you, and I'm gonna make sure that he does. I'm gonna do my part in your life to make sure that he, she, hears you. And that is the beauty of everybody in this room. In the words of Thomas Merton, perhaps we are stronger than we think. That everybody in this room has gone through something in their lives, and you survived it. But not only did you survive it, you took that trauma, that hurt, that revelation, or whatever it was, and you used it to connect, to give, to influence, to help. And that is the beauty and the purpose of what we are here on this earth to do. So for me, I lift a glass to everybody in this room who has decided to live a life bigger than themselves. Everybody who has decided to slay those dragons and say, it's not just about me. And I applaud you, and I am honored to be in this room with you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, yes. You better go ahead, Sandra. You better go ahead.
Yes, now we will have Julia Mayberry from Hatfield, grade 5.
Today, I will be reciting Kamala Harris's inauguration speech. But while I may be the first woman in this office, I will not be the last, because every little girl watching tonight sees that this is a country of possibilities. And to the children of our country, regardless of your gender, our country has sent you a clear message. Dream with ambition, lead with conviction, and see yourselves in a way that others may not. Simply because they've never seen it before. But know that we will applaud you every step of the way. And to the American people, no matter who you voted for, I will strive to be a vice president like Joe was to President Obama. Loyal, honest, and prepared, waking up every day thinking of you and your family. Because now is when the real work begins. The hard work, the necessary work, the good work, the essential work to save lives and beat this pandemic, to rebuild our economy so it works for working people, to root out systemic racism in our justice system and society, combat the climate crisis, to unite our country, and heal the soul of our nation. Thank you.
Way to go, Julia, way to go, Julia. And now we will have Jake Cully from Inglewood, grade 5.
Order reflects on Black Lives Matter movement. I know what it's like to live as though I'm on the outside looking in, as if I'm only allowed to exist on the fringes of society. Yeah, I remember those times. But I don't live like that anymore. I refuse to. From Miss Rosa Parks to Malcolm to Martin, as well as transgender activist Marsha P. Johnson, who boldly stood on the front lines at Stonewall in 1969. I will forever be grateful for those who have fought for us to be where we are today. And it is up to us to keep on fighting. And now, in the summer of 2020, young activists have flooded the streets around the globe to continue fighting for justice for Black people, for the LGBTQIA community. The world is changing right before our eyes, and it's a beautiful thing to see. None of us are promised tomorrow, so we have to take action and keep pushing to make our world a better place for all of us today.
Yeah, Jay.
Yeah.
Make sure he good. My man's Jay Kelly. Jay Kelly, one more time, Jay. Come on, right here, man. Gonna walk. Come here. Come on, right down the stairs. Walk down the stairs. There you go. And now we'll have Catherine Phillips from Montgomery Grade 5.
When day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, the sea we must wade. We've braved the belly of the beast. We've learned that quiet isn't always peace, and the norms and notions of what just is isn't always justice. And yet the dawn is ours before we knew it. Somehow we do it. Somehow we've weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We, the successors of a country, and at a time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves and raised by a single mother, can dream of becoming president only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from polished, far from pristine. But that doesn't mean we are striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge a union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of man. And so we lift our gaze, not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know how to put our future first. We must put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so we can reach out our arms to one another. We seek harm to none and harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, say this is true. That even as we grieved, we grew. That even as we hurt, we hoped. That even as we tired, we tried. That we'll forever be tied together, victorious. Not because we will never again sow division, but because we will never again know defeat. Scripture tells us to envision that everyone shall sit under their own vine and fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid. If we're to live up to our own time, then victory won't lie in the blade, but in all the bridges we've made. That is the promise to glade the hill we climb if only we dare. Every breath from my bronze-pounded chest, we will raise this wounded world into a wondrous one. We will rise from the golden hills of the West. We will rise from the windswept Northeast where our forefathers first realized revolution. We will rise from the lake rim cities of the Midwestern states. We will rise from the sun-baked South. And we will rebuild, reconcile, and recover. And every known nook of our nation, every corner called our country, our people diverse and beautiful will emerge battered and beautiful. When day comes, we step out of the shade of flame and unafraid. The new dawn balloons as we free it. For there is always light if only we are brave enough to see it. If only we are brave enough to be it.
We will rise and rebuild. As she said, we will rise and rebuild. Now, we'll have Peyton Jackson from Montgomery, grade 5.
Hello, everybody. My name is Peyton Jackson. I'm a fifth grader from Montgomery Elementary. I'm going to be reciting today, I Too, by Langston Hughes. I Too, sing America. I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes, but I laugh, eat well, and grow strong. Tomorrow, I'll be at the table when company comes. Nobody will dare say to me, eat in the kitchen then. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I too am America. I was born by the river in a little tent, and oh, just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. I don't know what's out there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. We are the change. Thank you.
Yeah, Peyton, yeah, Peyton. Been a long time coming.
Now we will have Olivia Taylor from General Nash, grade 5.
I will be performing a poem called Once Again by Mr. Lenore. Once again, a brother lies dead in the street. Once again, he screams, I can't breathe, with no relief. Once again, policemen stand idly by while. Once again, a man in blue condemns a black man to die. Once again, black lives really don't matter. Once again, a black body is crushed and shattered. Once again, black lives are under attack. Once again, a man dies because he's black. Once again, we pray, we march, we dissent. Once again, we rage, we cry, we vent. Once again, we ask, how can this still be? Once again, we answer, white supremacy.
Yes, yes. Can we have another round of applause for grades 4 through 5? Now, group 2, we'll have grades 6 through 7, starting with Molly Devine from Bridal Path, grade 6.
Speech is called Ain't I a Woman by Sojourner Truth, delivered at the 1851 Women's Convention in Akron, Ohio. Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Africans of the South and the women of the North, all talking about rights. But what's all this here talking about? The white men will be in a fix pretty soon. That man over there says that women need to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches and to have the best place everywhere. No one ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place, and ain't I a woman? Look at me, look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns, and no man could heed me, and ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it, and bear the lash as well, and ain't I a woman? Then they talk about this thing in the head. What's it that called? Intellect. That's it, honey. What's that got to do with women's rights or Africans' rights? If my cup won't hold but a pinch and yours holds a quart, wouldn't you be mean to not let me have my half measure full? Then that man in the back there, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? From God and a man and a woman. Man had nothing to do with him. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now they are asking to do it. The men better let them. Obliged to you for hearing me, and now old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say.
Way to kick it off, Molly. Way to kick it off. Yeah.
Now we will have Tatiana Pametun from Gwenor, grade 6.
Hi, today I will be performing Praise Song for the Day by Elizabeth Alexander, a poem for Barack Obama's presidential inauguration. Each day we go about our business, walking past each other, catching each other's eyes or not, about to speak or speaking. All about us is noise. All about us is noise and bramble, thorn and din. Each one of our ancestors on our tongues. Someone is stitching up a hem, darning a hole in a uniform, patching a tire, repairing the things in need of repair. Someone is trying to make music somewhere with a pair of wooden spoons on an oil drum, with a cello, boombox, harmonica, voice. A woman and her son wait for the bus. A farmer considers the changing sky. A teacher says, take out your pencils, begin. We encounter each other in words. Words, spiny or smooth, whispered or declaimed. Words to consider, reconsider. Say it plain, that many have died for this day. Sing the names of the dead who brought us here, who laid the train tracks, raised the bridges, picked the cotton and the lettuce, built brick by brick the glittering edifices. Praise song for struggle. Praise song for this day. Praise song for every hand-lettered sign. What if the mightiest word is love. Love beyond marital, filial, national. Love that casts a widening pool of light. Love with no need to preempt grievance. And today's sharp sparkle, this winter air, anything can be made. Any sentence begun on the brink, on the brim, on the cusp. Praise song for walking forward into that light.
Thank you, Tatiana, for that powerful speech, that powerful speech. Now we will have Jeffrey Jimmy from Gwinnett Scare, grade 6.
Hello, my name is Jeffrey Jimmy. I'm a sixth grader from Gwinnett Square Elementary School. Today, I'm going to recite a speech from Muhammad Ali called, I Am the Greatest. This is the legend of Cassius Clay, the most beautiful fighter in the world today. He talks a great deal and brags indeedy of a muscular punch that's incredibly speedy. The fistic world was dull and weary, but the champ like Liston, things had to be dreary. Then someone with color, someone with dash, with fight fans are running with cash. This brash young boxer is something to see, and the heavyweight championship is his destiny. This kid fights great, he's got speed and endurance, but if you sign to fight him, you better increase your insurance. This kid's got a left, this kid's got a right. If he hits you once, you'll sleep for the night. And as you lie on the ground, as the ref counts 10, you pray they wanted to fight me again. For I am the man this pawn is about. The next champ of the world, there isn't a doubt. When I say 3, they go into thirds. So don't bet against me, I'm a man of my word. It is befitting to leave the game just like I came in, beating a big bad monster who knocks at everybody and no one can whoop him. That's when the little Cassius Clay, who moves through Kentucky, came up to stop Sonny Liston, the man you know now for passing twice. He was gonna kill me, but he harmed George. His reach was long than George, needs better boxing, George, but I'm better now than I was. Who's that 22-year-old undeveloped kid ref from Sonny Liston? I'm experienced now and a professional. Jaw's been broke, but knocked down a couple times. I'm bad at something new plus fight. I've wrestled an alligator. That's right, I've wrestled an alligator. I've tussled with a whale and handcuffed Lennon but Thunder in jail. That's bad. Only last week I had murdered a rock, injured the stone, hospitalized the brick. I'm so mean I make medicine sick. I'm a bad dude, I'm bad, I'm fast. Last night I cut the light off in my bedroom and hit the switches and went in my bed for the room was dark. I'm fast. And you, George Woman, all you chums are gonna battle with him. All you. I knew you got him picked, but the man's in trouble. I'm so you are great, I am. I fly like a butterfly, sting like a bee. That's why they call me Muhammad Ali. Thank you.
Here you go, Jeff. I don't want no problems with Jeffrey, not at all. I don't want no problems. He said he got a left and a right. Ooh. So now we will have Iyanna Charitable from Gwinnett Square, grade 6.
When day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, a sea we must wade. We brave the belly of the beast. We learn that quiet isn't always peace, and the norms and notions of what just is isn't always justice. And yet the dawn is ours before we knew it. Somehow we do it. Somehow we weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We, the successors of a country in a time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves and raised by a single mother can dream of becoming president, only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from polished, far from pristine, but that doesn't mean we are striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge a union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of man. So we lift our gazes, not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know to put our future first, we must put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so we can reach out our arms to one another. We seek harm to none in harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, say this is true. Even as we grieved, we grew. Even as we hurt, we hoped. Even as we tired, we tried. That will be forever tied together. Victorious, not because we will never again know defeat, but because we will never again sow division. If we live up to our own time, then victories won't lie in the blade, but in the bridges we've made. That is the promise to glade the hill we climb, only if we dare. Because being American is more than pride we inherit. It's past we step into and how we repair it. We've seen a force that would shatter a nation rather than share it. We destroyed our country, even if that meant delaying democracy. This effort is nearly succeeded. But while democracy can be periodically delayed, it can never be permanently defeated. And this truth, in this faith we trust, for while our eyes are on the future, history has its eyes on us. In this era of redemption, we feared at its inception. We did not feel prepared to be in the heirs of such a terrifying hour. But within it, we found the power to author a new chapter, to offer hope and laughter to ourselves. So while we once asked, how could we possibly prepare over a catastrophe? Now we assert, how could catastrophe possibly prevail over us? We will not march back to what was, but move into how we should be. A country that is bruised but whole, benevolent but bold, fierce but free. We will not be turned around or interrupted by intimidation because we know in our inaction and inertia, we will be the inheritors of a new generation, become the future. Our blunters became their burden, but one thing is certain. If we merge mercy with might and might with right, then love becomes our legacy and chains our children's birthright. So let us leave behind a country better than we left it. Every breath from my brawn-pounded chest, we will raise this wounded world into a wondrous one. We will rise from the golden hills of the west. We will rise from the windswept northeast where our forefathers first realized revolution. We will rise from the lake-rimmed cities of the Midwestern states. We will rise from the sun-baked south. We will reconcile, rebuild, and recover in every known nook of our nation and every corner called our country. Our people, diverse and beautiful, will emerge battered and beautiful. When the day comes, we will step out of the shade, aflame and unafraid. A new dawn balloons as we free it. For there is always light if we are brave enough to see it, if we are brave enough to be it.
Way to go, Iyana, way to go. And now our next participant, who goes to General Naz, grade 6. Tell me your name.
Maya Angelou.
One more time, give me to him, one more time.
No good, Maya Angelou.
Clap it up, everybody, clap it up. Come on, y'all.
I will be reading Back to the Future by Amanda Gorman from Call Us What We Carry. At times, even blessings will bleed us. There are some who lost their lives and those who were lost from ours, who we might now re-enter. All are someone summoned softly. The closest we get to time travel is our fears softening, our hurts unclenching, as we become more keen, too keen, as we return to who we were before we were actually anything or anyone. That is, when we were born unhating and unhindered, howling wetly with everything we could yet become. To travel back in time is to remember when all we knew of ourselves was love.
And now we'll have Michaela Lewis.
I will be reciting Yara Shahidi, Black Girls Rock, acceptance speech. For many people, the definition of their identity is based on who we are not. It's based on who we don't want to be, who we don't want to be perceived like. White taught me what black was not. Male taught me what female was not. Straight taught me what gay was not. Sad taught me what happy was not. Law taught me what equality and equity were not. But our charge is to not live within this negative space of who we are not to be. Who are we not to be after all? Our community has sparked powerful, insightful, fierce black girls, and this community exists without definition and therefore without restriction. Black Girls Rock inspires us to lead in the midst of hard times, speak up for one another who are actively being silenced and pushed forward, the way our ancestors have so clearly planned for us to do. We thrive because we are. We are because we choose to be.
Way to go, way to go. And now we will have Angelica Garcia, who will be wrapping it up for the grades 6 through 7.
When the day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find the light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry a sea we must wade. We've braved the belly of the beast. We've learned that quiet isn't always peace. And the norms and notions of what just is isn't always justice. We, of a country and time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves, raised by a single mother, can dream of becoming president, only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from unpolished, far from pristine, but that doesn't mean we are striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge our union with purpose.
to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of man. So we lift our gazes not to what stands between us, but what stands before us, to close the divide, because we know to put our future first, we have to put our differences aside. So we lift our arms down so that we can reach them out to each other. Because we know to put our future first, we must put our differences aside. We seek harm to none and harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, prove this is true. Because even as we grieved, we grew. Even as we hurt, we hoped. Even as we tired, we tried. We are tied together, victorious. Not because we will never again know defeat, but because we will never again sow division.
Wonderful job, wonderful. 6th and 7th grade came with it. They came with it. Now we'll have Group 3, grades 8 through 12, starting off with Summer Kresge, who goes to Penfield, and she's in grade 8.
Good evening. Today I'm going to recite part of the inaugural poem, The Hill We Climb, by Amanda Gorman. When day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find this light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, the sea we must wade. We brave the belly of the beast. We've learned that quiet is always peace, and the norms and notations of just isn't always justice. And yet the dawn is ours before we knew it. Somehow we do it. Somehow we weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We, the successors of a country in a time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves and raised by a single mother can dream of becoming president, only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from polished, far from pristine, but that does not mean we're striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge our union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of man. And so we lift our gazes not to what stands between us, but to what stands before us. Because we know to put our future first, we must first put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so we can reach out our arms to one another. We seek harm to none and harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, say that this is true. That even as we grieved, we grew. That even as we hurt, we hoped. And that even as we tired, we tried. And that we'll forever be tied together, victorious. Not because we will never again know defeat, but because we will never again sow division. Scripture tells us to envision that everyone shall sit under their own vine and fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid. If we are to live up to our own time, then victory won't lie in the blade, but in all the bridges we've made. This is a promise to glade the hill we climb, if only we dare. It's because being American is more than a pride we inherit. It's a past we step into and how we repair it. We've seen a force that would shatter our nation rather than share it, would destroy our country if it meant delaying democracy. And this effort very nearly succeeded. But while democracy can be periodically delayed, it can never be permanently defeated. Thank you.
Now we will have Zayana Dobson, who's in grade 9.
Black in America by Charity Strong. So I'm standing in front of a man who I honestly love, and he just so happens to be white. Our conversation flows so easily, our dialect is like water filtered through a drain. Nothing ever feels forced. I'm never uncomfortable. He makes me feel so safe. And one day, like any other day, I'm engaging in conversation with him, and he just so poses the question, so what is it like to be Black in America? I pause. That question holds so many broken necks, so many body sways, so many unarmed bodies, so many tiki torches, so many tiki torched bodies, so many gunshot wounds, so many unknown faces, so many I can't breathes. So many paid leaves, so many guilty verdicts, so many not guilty verdicts, so many tears, so much blood, God, so much blood. I guarantee if we could combine all the pine sloths and black bread daily and add them all together, we'd have a blood bank for a lifetime. And in that moment, I was Mamie Till. So what is it like to be Black in America? It's terrifying. Thank you.
Now we'll have Glenn Xavier Pendale, grade 9.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Glenn Xavier, a ninth grade student at Penfield Middle School and North Penn High School. I am reciting an excerpt from the essay called In Defense of Self-Defense, published by Huey P. Newton on June 20, 1967. The colonized American felt that he had no choice but to raise the gun in defense of the welfare of the colonized people. Now, these same colonized white people have denied the colonized black man the right to even speak of abolishing this oppressive system which the white colonized American created. They have carried their madness to the four corners of the earth, and there is now a universal rebellion against their continued rule and power. The black people in America are the only people who can free the world, loosen the yoke of colonialism, and destroy the war machine. America cannot stand to fight every black country in the world and fight a civil war at the same time. It is militarily impossible to do both these things at once. The slavery of blacks in this country provides the oil for the machinery of war that America uses to enslave the peoples of the world. Without this oil, the machinery cannot function. We are the driving shaft. We are in such a strategic position in the machinery that once we become dislocated, the functioning of the remainder of the machinery breaks down. The racist dog oppressors have no rights which oppressed black people are bound to respect. As long as the racist dog oppressors pollute the earth with the evil of their actions, they deserve no respect at all. The power structure depends upon the use of force without retaliation. This is why they want the people unarmed. This is why they made it a felony to teach guerrilla warfare. The racist dog oppressor fears the armed people. They fear most of all black people armed with weapons and the ideology of the Black Panther Party for self-defense. And unarmed people are slaves or are subject to slavery at any given moment. When a mechanic wants to fix a broken down car engine, he must have the necessary tools for the job. When the people move for liberation, they must have the basic tool of liberation, the gun. Only with the power of the gun can the black masses halt the terror and brutality perpetuated against them by the armed racist power structure. And in one sense, only by the power of the gun can the whole world be transformed into the earthly paradise dreamed of by the people from time immemorial. One successful practitioner of the art and science of national liberation put it this way. We are advocates for the abolition of war. We do not want war, but war can only be abolished through war. And to get rid of the gun, it is necessary to take up the gun, Brother Mao Zedong. The blood, sweat, tears, and suffering of black people are the foundations of the wealth and power of the United States of America. We were forced to build America, and if forced to, we will tear it down. Thank you.
Can I get another round of applause for Glenn? Up next, we will have Phelan Rain Ashanti, who's a North Penn student.
I stand before you today as a candidate for the Democratic nomination for the presidency of the United States of America. I am not the candidate of Black America, although I am Black and proud. I am not the candidate of the women's movement of this country, although I am a woman and I am equally proud of that. I am not the candidate of any political fat cats or policies or special interests. I stand here now without endorsements from many big name politicians or celebrities or any other kind of prop. I do not intend to offer you the tired cliches that have too long been an accepted part of our political life. I am the candidate of the people of America. Fellow Americans, we have looked in vain to the Nixon administration for the courage, the spirit, the character, and the words to lift us, to bring out the best in us, to rekindle in each of us the faith of the American dream. Yet all that we have received in return is just another smooth exercise in political manipulation, deceit and deception, callousness and indifference to our individual problems, and the disgusting playing of divisive politics, pitting the young against the old, labor against management, North against South, Blacks against whites. The admitting concern of this administration has been one of political expediency rather than the needs of man's nature. The president has broken his promises to us and has therefore lost his claim to our trust and confidence in him. I cannot believe that this administration would have ever been elected 4 years ago if we had known what we know today. What we are entering a new era in which we must, as Americans, demand stature and size from our national leadership. Leadership which is fresh, leadership which is open, leadership which is receptive to the problems of all Americans. I have faith in the American people. I believe that we are smart enough to correct our mistakes. I believe that we are intelligent enough to recognize the talent, energy, and dedication that all Americans, including women and minorities, have to offer. I know from my travels to the cities and the small towns of America that we have vast potential, which can and must be put to constructive use in getting this great nation together. I know that millions of Americans from all walks of life agree with me that leadership does not mean putting the heir to the ground, to follow public opinion, but to have the vision of what is necessary and the courage to make it possible. Americans all over are demanding a new sensibility, a new philosophy of government from Washington. Instead of sending spies to snoop on participants at Earth Day, thank you very much.
All right, next up, my man 50 Grand, Kyrie Glass, everybody, Kyrie. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Kyrie Glass, and I'm going to be doing the poem called The Drowning Fish by Rudy Francisco. During the winter of 2015, the residents of Hampton Bay, Long Island, during the winter of 2015, the residents of Hampton Bay, Long Island, woke up to what they say was the worst smell they have ever experienced. Mysteriously, overnight, 1,000 fish had died in the canal. After thorough analyzation, they found that the oxygen level in the water was too low and all the fish had drowned. Upon hearing the news, many had questions like, how can a fish drown? How can a fish drown? Don't they have gills? Don't they have fins? Don't they have tails? They asked questions like, aren't they built to survive in that environment? Perhaps this is the best analogy for my depression. This angry deity, this jealous god, this thirsty shadow that wrings my joy like a dish rag, turns every conversation into a conveyor belt that always begins with the phrase, you look tired today. To be honest, getting out of my bed has become a magic trick, and I'm probably the worst magician I know. The sadness is the only clean shirt I have left, and my washing machine has been broken for months. When people ask me how I'm doing, I want to say that my daughter is 4 years old and I'm still not sure if I'm a good father. I want to say that my dad is being diagnosed with dementia. There might be a day when I walk into the room and he doesn't recognize me, and I always wanted us to start all over, but I guess you got to be careful what you ask for. I guess when you pray for something, you have to be a little bit more specific. I guess I want to say crickets have been known to eat their own wings, and I too have a tendency to destroy what helps me get off the ground. I really want to say that I'm not in a good place right now, but that's not the polite answer, so instead, I pretend and it's Halloween, I jack-o'-lantern my face into something exceptional, and I tell others that I'm fine until it sounds like the truth. But sometimes there's a help me chained to the ankle of I'm doing okay. Sometimes I'm fine. It's the quickest way to say I don't want to talk about it. Sometimes all the oxygen in the room becomes water, and it feels like I'm sinking to the bottom, like I'm running out of air. But I made a promise to myself that I won't be another drowning fish, that I won't die in this canal. I heard that if you just breathe and relax, the human body naturally floats on top of the water. So I breathe, and I tell myself that it's going to be okay. I cry, and I tell myself it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay, because I know there's a better version of me somewhere in the future, and he is staring right here at this moment, and he's saying, Kyrie, thank you for not giving up on us. A few days ago, I was reading and I saw a run-on sentence. And I thought to myself, you know, it could have just stopped right there. But it found a reason to keep going. I smiled and I said to myself, same. Thank you.
I tried to tell y'all about Kyrie. I tried to tell y'all. You better go ahead, Kyrie. You better go ahead. But up next, my brother from another mother, David Lyons from North Penn.
Hello, my name is David Lyons, and I'm a junior at North Penn High School. It's a pleasure to speak to you all this evening. During an NBC interview on May 8, 1967, Dr. Martin Luther King explained why Black Americans face more obstacles than white immigrants. White America must see that no other ethnic group has been a slave on American soil. That is one thing that other immigrant groups haven't had to face. The other thing is that the color became a stigma. American society made the Negro's color a stigma. America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land or nothing in reality and as a matter of fact to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base, and yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years any kind of economic base. And so, emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate. And therefore, it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. Now, I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps. But it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading. Thank you.
My man. That's my man right there. Put these damn plates up.
So now I have the honor of I have the honor of our last participant, who is a senior here at North Penn, and she's an assistant. Don, what are you again? She's assistant president of the AAAC, our African Americans Awareness Club, and she'll be performing. And Dom, you helped me, you my soul sister, when we participated in our event. Me and you, we sung Lift Every Voice and Sing. We can YouTube NPTV. You know what I'm saying? You're gonna see me in action. Amen. But now, Dom, thank you so much. You're a senior here. This will be your last year. And I appreciate you, everything you've done for me, all the times that I was down, you know what I'm saying, in my little bag or whatever. You brought me out there. You brought my enthusiasm out, my personality. I wanna thank you for that, personally. So now, Dominic Bethel, y'all, North Penn, senior.
That was real sweet. I wasn't expecting him to say all that. But so before I start, I just wanted to give you a brief summary of who I was doing. It's Miss Fannie Lou Hammer, and she's testifying at the to a credentials committee. And this was in 1964, and this was in front of the Democratic National Convention. And she talks about her tragedies and her the way she was tortured when trying to get to register. So that's what I'm doing. As soon as I was seated on the bus, I saw as they began to put five people in the highway patrolman's car. I stepped off the bus to see what was happening, and someone screamed from the car that the five workers was in and said, "Get that one there." When I went to the car, when the man told me I was under arrest, he kicked me. I was carried to the county jail and put into the booking room. They left some of us in the booking room and began to place us in the cells. I was placed in a cell with a young woman named Miss Yvesta Simpson. After I was placed in a cell, I could hear the sounds of licks and screams. I could hear the sounds of licks and horrible screams. I could hear someone say, "Can you say yes, sir? Can you say yes, sir?" along with other horrible names. She said, "Yes, I could say yes, sir." "Well, say it." She said, "I don't know you well enough." They beat her. I don't know for how long, but after a while, she began to pray and ask God to have mercy on those people. It wasn't long before three white men came into my cell. One of them, the state highway patrolman, asked where I was from, and I said, "Ruleville." And he said, "We're gonna go check this." They left my cell and they came back, and he said, "You're from Ruleville, all right." And he said, "You gonna wish you was dead." I was carried from my cell into another cell where they had two Negro prisoners. The state highway patrolman ordered the first Negro to take the blackjack. I was then ordered by the first Negro from orders from the state highway patrolman to lay on the bunk bed on my face. I laid on my face, and the first Negro began to beat. I was beat until the first Negro was exhausted. I held my hands behind me at the time on my left side because I suffered from polio at the age of 6 years old. After the first Negro had beat me until he was exhausted, the state highway patrolman ordered the second Negro to beat. When the second Negro began to beat, I began to work my feet. And the state highway patrolman ordered the first Negro who had beat me to sit on my feet, to keep me from working my feet. And I screamed. And one white man got up and came over, and he beat me in the head and told me to hush. One white man, my dress had worked up high, he pulled my dress, I pulled it back down, and he pulled it back up. I was in prison when Medgar Evers was murdered. All this because we wanted to register, to become first-class citizens. If the Freedom Democratic Party isn't seated now, I question America. Is this America? The land of the free and home of the brave? Where our telephones are hanging off the hooks because we get threatened daily? Just because we want to live as decent human beings in America. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
We want to give another round of applause for all our participants. All of y'all did wonderful, all of y'all. And now as the judges tally up the votes, there will be a presentation of The Colors of Pride, where I'll be starring and singing just a little bit. Just a little bit, I can't really sing for real. They just... Mr. Gross wanted me to sing, but look. So we'll have the Colors of Pride, and then after that, the awards and ceremonies by our assistant superintendent, Dr. Deanna Waters.
Turn to the sun. Weight on my shoulders, a bullet in my gun. Oh, I got eyes in the back of my head, just in case I have to run. Do what I can when I can while I can for my people. Watch the clouds roll back and the stars fill the night. That's when I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to keep it on. I can feel it in my bones. Early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, ooh, I'm gonna start a move. And I fight with the strength that I got until I die. So I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, you hear freedom calling, calling me to answer. Gonna keep on keeping.
And now for our presentation of our awards, our Assistant Superintendent, Dr. Deanna Waters.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. Did you have a good time tonight? Our students are so talented in North Penn School District. Yes, I'm Dr. Deanna Waters, one of the assistant superintendents, and really happy to be here tonight. I'm gonna thank a few people, but before I do that, I would love for, I'm gonna just pull this down, I'll stand 6 feet away, let me move over. If we could have the performers come on up, because you are all winners. So if you guys could just kind of let them kind of form behind me. Okay, so really quickly, because I know that you're all waiting to hear the winners, and so am I, but again, you're all winners in my book. I want to start first with our superintendent, Dr. Dietrich, who just always embraces these types of events. He just, when we ask to do things like this, he's always like, absolutely yes. So Dr. Dietrich, come on up. Our board directors, I think our president, Tina Stoll, is here. Dr. Wanda Lewis-Campbell, Mrs. Julianne Romich. I have to thank our Goal 4 Tri-Chairs. They are Mr. Ty Gross, Mr. Nick Taylor, and Dr. Marjorie Dieg, along with their Goal 4 committee, who really worked hard to put this event together. I know a few of them are backstage. There's Mrs. Lisa Chapman, Mrs. Susie Kyola. Come on out. I think one of our PI parents is somewhere out there, Mrs. Lauren Wilson, who co-chairs that committee with Mrs. Alexis Drolet. But a lot of the PI parents are here volunteering tonight. We thank you for that. I have to shout out our Voices of Empowerment. They are students who work, or they do work, but they are students in a club over at Pendale Middle School led by Mrs. Brooke Bernardini, who is here this evening. They decorated the lobby. They came, they put the posters out. They ushered you in. They welcomed you. I have to thank them. Our Communications Department, they are amazing. Mrs. Christine Liberoski, Mary Fakish, Bob Gilmer, Craig Wireman, and our North Penn team. TV student crew. Thank you to Merck, the League of Employees of African Descent, for your support, your donations, and they actually purchased comic books, Dr. Boston comic books, made by Mr. George Whitehair, one of our judges. Thank you for that. Again, I'd like to thank our esteemed judges. You could be anywhere tonight, and we really appreciate you being here with us. Thank you. And I also need to shout out our MC, Mr. Isaiah Ja, our singer, Myra Jefferson, the jazz band that was here from North Penn High School. So we just had students doing a whole lot tonight because they are just amazing. And of course, we have to thank the families. We can't do it without you. You are our partners. Give your parents a nice round of applause. And of course, we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for these lovely people behind me. So students, thank you for everything. Thank you for putting in so much hard work. You were incredible this evening. And I also want to just thank all the staff, administrators, teachers who were here for your encouragement. A lot of you are the reason why your students are behind me tonight. So thank you for being here as well. I'm going to turn it over now. You ready? You have the result?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Nick Taylor.
All right, the moment everyone's been waiting for today. So again, if y'all could just give another round of applause for an outstanding job by our contestants here. So for group one, coming in third place, Peyton Jackson. All right, so now for second place, or the runner-up, Catherine Phillips. All right, and the winner for group one, Savani Wagmar. All All right, give it up again for group one. All right, now, for the winners for group two. Coming in third place, Jeffrey Jimmy. In second place for group two, Michaela Lewis. All right, and for tonight's group two winner, in first place, Tantiana Pamatun. Now, for last group, group three, coming in third place, Kyrie Glass. All right, and so for the first time since the Black Oratorical Competition has been taking place, it's not a Steve Harvey moment, but we have two first place winners. We have two contestants who had a virtually tied score, starting with David Lyons. David, when we're done, you could just take it to the wood shop and split it in half, because you're going to split it with the next first place winner. Give a big round of applause for Dominique Bethel. All right, so outstanding job by everyone tonight. And although we do have a hierarchy of placement, I can't commend you all enough for your bravery to come up here and speak your truth and speak beautiful words. You all did an outstanding job, and you should be very proud of yourselves. So thank you again. Another shining moment, what North Penn is about. Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.